This act, speaking generally, is about public opinion, but of course, only as if in a dream.
She gets a call from the city, stronger for what she's been through. The future no longer a burden. Hang no regrets in the closet. Speak sharply if I disagree. About now, the radio station. She is unsure of the moral, but the song has something for her in it. A positive, negative feeling on irony, language, and greed.
Here come guys, look at that son, Jay. He's a big swinger. He got a wife and her name, Jay. She's a home digger. They got a son, he named Boy. He's a gunslinger, living in a tree, hoping to be a rock and roll son. Hanging around with the apes, what a way to raise a family. One day he'll come into that hey, movie director. He sees Charles doing his thing. He's quite effective. He said, Charles, have a cigar, man. You've been selected. You represent that one element that can't be corrected. Tarzan and Jane signed up with the man for some compensation. Lock up the lucky, wash up the boy, leave from the station. Taking their thing to the world capital of civilization. Hoping to achieve, you can believe self-realization. Now boy's doing fine, got a thing going. He gone electric. Tarzan and Jane, man, they got a thing that's very selective. A lot of fine clothes and three or four cars and a private detective. To guard all the things that Tarzan regard as a social corrective. Hanging around with the apes, what a way to raise a family. Like all the rest of us, Tarzan and Jane sometimes feel sentimental. The pool is cool, but the flow is slow. The drain's taken off. The neighbors are in some strange in their ways, whose troubles are enough. The house and the trees and the breeze sweet and gentle. Hanging around with the apes all day. What a winner as a family.
The song stays on the air for some weeks, infecting almost everyone. If it is not so good in the world capital of civilization, where is it good? Celebrities continue to die of disappointment. The very poor continue to die of hunger. The unrecognized continue to die of striving. And in the meantime, as if in a dream, the parties go on almost nightly in the city. At a party, one drinks cautiously, avoids the room where the heavy smokers have gathered, expresses for the record some degree of vulnerability in matters of health, habit, and desire, tries to be helpful, waits inconspicuously, exchanges dreams with strangers.
Last night I dreamed that...
Just a moment, please.
I'm sorry. Last night I dreamed that... This is a common dream.
A woman recently hurt by circumstances begins her dream with the insight that the dream itself, which we have not experienced, remember, is a common dream for her.
I'm sorry. What I meant was that last night I dreamed as I ordinarily do, and I wanted you to know that the dream was a common one for me. which I thought you could not know unless I told you.
Just a moment, please.
I'm sorry. I dreamed that I was standing in a beautiful meadow on an almost cloudless day. The meadow seemed to go on in soft rolling hills almost forever. It was covered with early summer flowers.
Just a
moment,
please.
The sun was shining. I'm sorry. The sun was shining. I was alone. I was at peace with myself. It was a rare moment. It was without any foreboding.
The dream began in foreboding. To appreciate that the dream is commonplace even before the dream has begun is a version of foreboding.
I'm sorry. There was no foreboding. If I gave you that impression, it was a mistake. There was no foreboding. That is the part of the dream that I don't understand. The moment that is so memorable in the dream came with no foreboding. Unlike most
just a
moments
moment,
in my
please.
Life, I'm sorry. This is hard
just
for
a
me
moment,
to explain.
Please.
I'm sorry. What is hard to explain is that I was taken so much by surprise by what happened, and at the very same time it seemed so natural. It was surprising and natural
just
at
a
the
moment,
same time.
Please.
I'm sorry. It was such a pleasure to be surprised. I had forgotten.
A woman is shaken by the absolute rarity of
I'm
a dream.
Sorry. I was standing in a vast meadow that was at the same time the front yard of my house. I had those feelings at the same time. I don't remember any details from the dream that gave me the idea that the meadow was the front yard of my house. But the feeling of the identity was clear. And I remember it clearly even now.
The language of describing the dream describes the foreboding, intentionally or not. The memory of the dream has no sense of foreboding. The language describes an image with two identities. The memory of the dream reconciles the two.
I'm sorry. Neither of those things seemed important to me compared to the power the dream
had. Just a moment, please.
I'm sorry. As I was standing in the meadow, an airplane flew over at a great height. It was an old type of airplane with a propeller engine. That sound is easy to recognize. I could barely see the airplane, it was so high. But when I noticed the sound, the airplane was almost directly overhead. The idea of the distance of the airplane is very clear.
The language for describing the dream is full of foreboding.
I'm sorry. I don't know any other way to tell the story of the dream without telling you why the dream could surprise me so and still seem natural.
The image of the dream has about the structure of foreboding.
I'm sorry. I'll go right to the thing that happened in the dream.
Just a moment, please.
I'm sorry. Somebody called to me from the airplane. They called my name. I could hear it as clearly as if the caller were only a few feet away, but the sound of the call was at a great distance. The sound of the call came
just a
from
moment,
the airplane.
Please.
I'm sorry. There was a great difference between the sound of the call and the sound that I could imagine coming from the airplane. Especially because the sound of the airplane engine was so natural.
A woman is distressed by a dream because the image of the dream differs from any image in her experience.
I'm sorry. The dream made me very happy, and it was memorable because it was so surprising
just
and so natural
moment,
at the same
please.
Time. I'm sorry. I'm finished telling about the dream. That's all there was to it. I was standing in a meadow that had some kind of meaning that I could feel. An airplane flew over to great height. A voice called to me, called my name from the airplane. It was all very clear.
The offering of images as a spiritual activity replaces the impulse to find a personal vision and icon. As a spiritual activity, it distracts the individual from the task of finding and recognizing a singular true path. The offering of images categorizes human activity and offers the sum of the categories as a sum of possibilities and alternatives, each one of which must be equally good and equally valid, else the system of categories breaks down. Like modernism, science, and theater as we know it, the offering of images and Protestantism hand in hand are egalitarian, democratic, and communistic. The offering of images is a secular spiritual activity. The offering of images has in our era attached itself as a spiritual activity to Judaism as a secular corrective to mysticism and individualism. The offering of images is a secularization of Judaism as Protestantism is a secularization of Christianity. Modernism is the secularization of taste. Science is the secularization of memory. And theater as we know it is a secularization of experience. There are other examples, but you get the idea. Remember that we have yet to find a language that is common to the Occident and Orient, except for the language of technology. Consider then the difficulties of speaking to the fourth world, the world of those who are different, with a difference that is independent of geography, for instance, the mentally different. Secularization must exclude the mentally different by definition. The mentally different share no images with us, and they share no history with us. The mentally different cannot be modern. The mentally different cannot be twisted in science. The mentally different cannot appreciate theater as we know it. One supposes that other differences than mental differences separate the fourth world from the three that communicate with such difficulty now. For instance, feeling. Suppose for a moment that beginning this instant, while nothing in you changes mentally, you enter into a state of permanent rapture, maybe not more intense than the pleasure you felt standing in the meadow of your imagination and being addressed by name without the ambiguity of distance by some animate being or knowing system in an elevated position. To simplify the image a great deal without changing it structurally, but as intense and without the encumbrance of the image. I think this is what is meant by pure bliss. The feeling without the image. You could not be modern. You could not be trusted in science. You could not appreciate theater as we know it. You would be in the same relationship to the real world, 1, 2, and 3, as if you were mentally different, and you would never be able to communicate to those worlds that while intent upon a state of permanent rapture, you are mentally okay. You could do it by reference to the dream. But remember, you would not have had the dream, might not know what dreams were, and to try to communicate through the image of the dream would reveal the passing nature of your rapture. The fourth world is different from the other three. Otherwise, we wouldn't need words at all, and it is different in the words. Now, the problem you will have in dealing with your dream as a yardstick in your life is that it will fade. The greatest of the prophets, Moses, the first Jew we can remember, was very discouraging about the use of images. He thought that any attempt to animate the world in one's imagination, to give it any meaning at all, is a big mistake. If you, for instance, think of dogs as little because they are smaller than you think you are, you have a long way to go before you rest. Traditionally, when imagination becomes too strong, cultures resort to very strong chemical treatment, usually from the vegetable world, to burn off the waste, which is where the imagination arises. I think you must do some of that. Don't be frightened of the first stage in which the imagination is purposely inflamed. Remember who you are, stay near help, and don't give up. Eventually, you will come to pure bliss. The images will disappear, dreams will stop. You won't need me.
Thank you, Doctor. Not too well said, but something. Granted, it's a hard idea. Hard to express and far from reassuring. But we'll keep your card on file, just in case.
I can't imagine why I told that after my dream. We had just been introduced. We might have made friends. It was like I was showing him pictures of my family from my wallet.
$14.28 for your thoughts, Linda.
I'm sorry. I was daydreaming.
You're not kidding. I've been sending you signals for the last 5 minutes.
I was thinking about that doctor I met at the party last night.
And you know what he wanted? You're looking tired.
Do I look tired?
You're not taking care of yourself.
I thought I looked good. He should have seen me a year ago.
Now, what have you had to eat today? Don't leave anything out. Even a cup of coffee counts.
There was my alarm radio. I left music on for about 20 minutes. Then I wanted to get the weather. I turned it off.
Music has no calories. But you have to count the toothpaste.
I got some soap in my mouth when I was washing my face.
Ah, but I can list them for you.
I don't know about that.
Coffee.
First tea. More caffeine.
Toast with butter.
100 calories.
Orange juice.
This is 16 hours ago.
Your morning cigarette.
My morning cigarette. The newspaper.
Headlines, pictures, astrology, recipes with guilt, pictures of women.
You can only count what you put in your body.
I can only count what I put in my body. What about the pictures?
Okay, you can count the pictures, but not the astrology.
What about the flowers you gave me? What about the smells?
If you count smells, you have to count the bad ones too.
Okay, no smells.
Do it as fast as you can. I'll bet you can't get half of them.
Half of what?
The toothpaste. I got soap in my mouth. One prescription antihistamine. Half a Valium. 2 cups of tea with nothing. Glass of orange juice. Piece of toast with butter. 2 cups of black coffee, 2 nicotine cigarettes, small amount of cocaine.
My mouth now wish I could go back to the real way.
1 nicotine cigarette.
But that's gone forever. Regret.
Toothpaste. Trace of mouthwash. 4 cigarettes. Black coffee. Part of a sweet roll. 3 nicotine cigarettes. Part of a marijuana cigarette. 1 nicotine cigarette. Glass of red wine. 2 slices of French bread with butter, some eggs cooked in milk and flour with small pieces of vegetables almost too small to count, some lettuce with some kind of oil, cheap olive oil and vinegar and garlic, black coffee, 1 nicotine cigarette, part of a marijuana cigarette, some nicotine cigarettes, black coffee, a piece of chocolate candy, little bit of cocaine, some nicotine cigarettes, alcohol and fruit juice, salty fried
Who
things.
Who can tell anymore?
Glass of wine, 1 nicotine
She'll never
cigarette.
Finish.
A complicated
Meat and
dinner,
vegetables, all
I can't
kinds of
do
flavor,
it all.
Sugar.
Black coffee. Nicotine cigarettes, a
small amount
of cocaine. This is all mixed
Sweet
up
things,
now.
Cheese, wine, cigarettes, part of a marijuana cigarette.
Smoke from some powder
this is
heated up, but they say it's a kind
she
of opium.
No cells to
and
her house
here
back then.
We are.
She is, and here he is.
More black coffee and more sweet things. When we get back to the car, I'll give you some more cocaine. I could give it to you now, and you could do it in the bathroom.
No thanks.
Men give drugs to women.
What happens when you get home?
Cigarettes, a cup of tea to make me sleep, maybe some marijuana.
Do you think that you could get through a whole day on your own?
Do you mean without prayer?
Very funny. Do you pray?
Do moods count?
What do you mean?
What does she mean?
Sometimes I get in a certain mood and I think it must be what
Maybe I thought you had to actually do something.
You mean like get down on your knees?
Well, maybe I thought that was
the point.
What do you mean?
She wants to know what he means.
I thought you had to humiliate yourself or something like that.
I guess I don't pray then.
She doesn't pray then.
You do exercises.
She does exercises.
Not anymore.
Not anymore.
During this conversation, a man seated at another table with a party of other men has begun attracting her attention in the crudest kind of way. Where do they come from, these guys? What do they do when they're not acting like this? The men are laughing loudly. She and her companion are the subject of the jokes. That's obvious. She is afraid of what is happening.
I think we ought to go now.
They ought to go now.
I do too. Those drunks are making me mad.
Don't do anything.
She asks him not to do
Just
anything.
Ignore
she
them.
To ignore them.
We can pay the waiter on
the
way out.
They stand to go to walk by the men. Laughing at them is the direct way. To take another path would invite comment. She walks past the table ahead of her companion. As he starts to walk past the same spot, the man at the table leans back suddenly, knocking him into a person at a third table. Much laughter. Her companion puts the coats he is carrying, his and hers, on the nearest chair and hits the man who leaned into him. More or less in the face, this is what it has been leading up to. 2 other men from the table grab her companion. Clumsily, the fourth is laughing loudly. She notices how much the men are grunting. Other people in the restaurant are talking loudly. 2 waiters are there almost immediately. Their authority prevails. The man who was attracting her attention fakes some kind of emotion. He calls her ugly names. There is still pushing and shoving a woman from another table is talking loudly to the drunken man who started the trouble. He answers her in vile language. Her companion then strikes the drunk very hard and quickly.
the drunk is obviously hurt, his face is bleeding. The other three men from the party talk loudly, but they are afraid. Suddenly there are two policemen in the room. Everybody is surprised. Why are they here with so much authority? The drunken men pretend that they are sober, but they respond too quickly to the policemen and to the commands they argue. The younger waiter explains quickly to the policeman he called them earlier. He saw the trouble coming. There is very little discussion. This is the source of the police authority. They have learned not to listen unless they have asked to be told. They are not interested in blame before anyone is aware that it has been done. They have the names of everyone in the restaurant. They have moved the four drunken men to the sidewalk. Another police car arrives, lights flashing, but the policemen do not come into the restaurant. The four drunken men are gone. One of the policemen speaks briefly to the man who struck the drunken herd, and the man looks very sad. His wife is trying to console him. The waiter explains that the restaurant does not expect to be paid. The man and woman leave quickly without speaking. The waiter apologizes for what happened. He saw the trouble coming, but he didn't know how to stop it. Called the police, they didn't get here in time.
Four nicotine cigarettes.
A little bit of brandy. It's always too strong. Why do people drink it?
Marijuana. End of the cocaine. Five grains.
Use the broken tap tomorrow.
Toothpaste.
A fake mint flavor.
And the troubles are put aside. Well, not quite. Let's say. Put inside, best not thought of, but the city has lost its charm. And what follows is a record of rewards without sweetness. What else is there to say?
She makes a name for herself at work. She speaks sharply if she disagrees, attracting respect for her opinions. She wins a large cash prize in the lottery. She allows her picture in all the papers, showing a permanent disbelief.
This is as high as I can go. How do you know that you know it?
She is trapped with a man in an elevator. She imagines he looks like her father. Television is there when they get out. Approaching the present, time is compressed toward an infinite, now infinitely past. She tells him, what am I dealing with?
This is as high as I can go. How do you know that you know it?
She finally buys an apartment in town through a cousin who works in the government and does real estate on the side. The picture window reminds her of dawn. It looks west toward what could be water. The best views are of the body army.
This is as high as I can go. How do you know that you know it?
She inherits a place in the country. She visits once and then puts it in trust. Four cousins are cousins from cousins forever. She visits Europe, partially business. She sees too much that reminds her of home. But a sense of the past is still there.
This is as high as I can go. How do you know that you know it?
Back home, she encounters a man from the restaurant. She feels sympathy and he doesn't know her. He wears the same brown shirt and tie. She finally remembers her companion's name. She lists everything she's done today. All diet and exercise, thoughts for the future.
This is as high as I can go. How do you know that you know it?
We
we've reached the end almost. You can read in the voice, not to mention what you said. So imagine now for the next few minutes an older woman, still beautiful, sense of wonder intact, playing bridge with friends, the daydreaming inseparable from the narrative, such as it is. Notice that she tries to tell us about something unusual and experience. She doesn't tell it very well, then a little for her son than what's in the cards.
Places better
on the horizon.
The wanderer copyright
pretends she doesn't
the way she thinks.
Now the idea of
refuge, the idea of
looking ahead to
the sun and a pool.
Wherever she goes,
she learns the dances.
She learns the language
faster than anyone.
Miami, Cuba, Chicago, Germany,
Hollywood,
Aslan,
then gone.
Oh well, forget it.
Scrapbooks from home.
Old occupations.
A craze for religion.
Changes her name.
Jesus brings happiness.
Changes it back.
Thinks she sees.
I'm almost positive.
Tan with a mustache.
More heavy and serious.
Careless with urgency.
Troubled she watches.
She follows.
Unthinking.
He disappears.
She follows.
Approaches.
He disappears.
He's gone.
Oh well, forget it.
For a few days she thinks she should consult with someone, but these are the kinds of things that when you tell people that's what you've experienced and that's what concerns you, they misunderstand and take your concern for your sanity more seriously than they take the experience what it might mean if it were simply factual and uninterpreted.
Those men go out to space in those little capsules with their brains and their imaginations tested for any possible thing going wrong. But they come back changed by something, and then we stop believing them and believing in them when just recently their experiences were an ultimate authority for us. And their reports of their experiences were all we had.
In other words, at the moment when you most need help, in the form of belief in the authority of your experience, the extent of the experience, how it compares to others, its power, is the very way we measure whether the experience is something you might have had or whether it is just something you dreamed up and you really need a different kind of help.
I'm almost positive.
But then...
Does it change anything?
Whoever it was.
Did it the same?
What I said, though.
He seemed to know.
No sign of...
Recognition.
And he seemed to know.
He was closer than you are.
Three steps away.
I saw the sign.
Not recognition.
Acknowledgement.
Which card is the red one?
Then gone.
Oh well, forget it.
It occurs to her finally that unless there are to be many of these things in her life and the whole life, changes in tune with them, then she is allowing the experience to cast a shadow over other kinds of things that are more important to her, and that before the experience had gone unnoticed, unattended, and unexplored. She says to herself whenever she gets trapped now in the how many of us are there kind of questions, you have to learn to keep your mouth shut about something that is only part of you, even if it is unusual, or that part of you will get in the way of having the pleasure of the other parts.
That's harder than you think, because as we all know, palaces of the imagination are full of people who have no imagination to speak of. Something happened to them that no one believes. They have become untrustworthy in our eyes. We must convince them that they are wrong.
Years pass.
Years pass.
It's forgotten.
It's forgotten.
Just forgotten.
Just forgotten.
Proving that one.
Proving that one.
Experience.
Experience.
Among many is.
One among many.
Learn to play bridge.
Learn to play bridge. The pleasure.
Pleasure of company.
Systems of memory.
Systems of memory.
Cards out of focus.
Cards out of focus.
How to remember.
How to remember.
Memories shared.
Memories shared.
I used to smoke cigarettes.
I used to love dancing.
I used to stay up late.
Then gone.
Nearest of all in memory is Mr. Payne. It could end so suddenly, so completely. And who remembers what the reason was? I heard much after it had happened that he had been seriously hurt. It seemed almost unimaginable to me. It was clear when I was with him that he had to suffer. That was written all over him. The suffering was there, had probably always been there in him. It must have come to him and been accepted by him when he was very young. But hurt is different from suffering. It's a kind of insult, and so it was unimaginable that both could be together in one person, and that that person could endure. Next nearest in memory is the guy. What is his name? This moment, now. This moment, no. Now it's too late. If it's not there, it's never been a part of you. The doctor told a funny story about a man who lost his fiancée's name when he was introducing her to someone at the announcement party. She walked out and refused to go through with the marriage. The doctor was sure that she had done the right thing, and I asked if he meant that from a defensive point of view, or whether you could take it from the point of view of jousting or whatever. He didn't understand my question. The guy I wanted to put nearest to Mr. Payne, the guy next in my life, the nameless one, could never understand what I was telling him about myself. We always stayed up too late, and he could never understand everything a girl could want, except I had to leave. Who was next in memory? Oh, yes, my days with the founder of the Paris Salon of Beauty Incorporated. I am a reductionist by appointment. A charming view with modernistic furniture and a closet full of French clothing in America. Imagine those characters in the closet plotting. The angry exiles, their revolution. That was the most fun about him, and I couldn't tell him. He was a charmer with certainty like sunshine. Nothing without a reason, daylight, no whispers. I heard a constant whirring motion, high-pitched. The idea of the perfect machine admired. What does it take to make one stop looking? First, midnight dancing in the arcade cathedral. Pure happiness, if that word means anything. Then, this is funnier than I thought, prosperity. Gourmet foods from around the world, 24 hours. Finally, the idea of the perfect body, forgetfulness. You'd think I'd look a little better than I do. I'd like to read you this letter from my son. My pride is boundless. It seems so perfect. The way he has found a life that pleases him. His mind is so clear about what he calls reality. No grudge against his father. No grudge against his mother, I hope. No trace of something hanging in the air about him. Where did he learn to dress so well? How did he come by such confidence and poise? After what he went through, it makes him very happy. Dear Mom, everything is going well. I love the summer and the winter here. I hope to get a new assignment. The office has a new large project. They call it by a famous painter's name. You'll read about it in the papers. When you do, you'll know where I am. That's as much as I can say. I meet the most interesting people. Yesterday it was a man who sells. I have to think about the way to say this. A very common object that we never see. Couldn't get anywhere without it. Old as the wheel. And that's a hint. Some Italians thought about it differently. That's as much as I can say. Anyway, we bought thousands of them. Does that give you an idea? He's the strangest man I've ever seen. Didn't care about the office project. Didn't know the painter's name. Took the executive washroom for 2 hours. Can you imagine 2 hours? I asked a person whose name you know. Why don't we do business with him? You'll never guess the answer. He makes the best ones in the world. The common object that we never see. 2 hours in the executive washroom. So what? Disturbs the office staff. So what? The best ones in the world. He calls his employees my subjects. And there's funnier stuff than that. Incredible pictures of his family. We're in stitches. He's around a few more days. Then he goes off on contract for the office. A consultation, God knows what they'll see. The office has a large-scale project. I said that already, didn't I? The project's in my specialty. Maybe the reason I was hired. I want to measure the unmeasurable. Reconcile the incommensurable. The world could use this. And I like the painter's name. It even sounds like success. If you begin with what is silent as in swimming. Remember that old joke? Then make the second sound. First drop the S. Broader as in father. Then add an O as in say regret for a father lost. That's as much as I should say. I'll write to you again soon. Maybe I'll have a permanent address. Meantime, use the office one. Letters get to me eventually. Hope your bridge is getting better. Love, your hardworking son. His specialty is measuring the use of energy in what he calls unknown systems. As far as I can understand it, he thinks about whether humans could exist on other food than what we call food. Imagine. He thinks vitamins are old-fashioned, but a good idea. I take them. God only knows what he takes. I love his letters, but I can't understand them. He's so secretive. But what he can't tell me in this one will be in the papers and on TV tomorrow. Just wait and see.
And that's the end of Linda's story, Playing Bridge with Friends. Sharing pictures from the past, too complicated for photography.
This is the last hand, it's getting late. North Berlin, a tango mixed emotions. East, River Rouge, the Red River, the movement. South, Cambodia, Fury, Rome, early warning. West, Atlantis, where we came before and now are joined.
Tentative end of two minds, she.
About the tango records,
and about nostalgia here.
And in the pause, questions of
respectability about
nostalgia, great distances,
longings, fear, and bravery mixed.
Argentina, etc.
Look, the boy has wild yellow hair.
A cafe,
everyone's a spy.
Green hair, dark hair, layered bands of
maybe places
in the open.
Graffiti, bay, advertisements
for music, sir, not anarchy.
Correct, her English is happy.
Proud and fearful,
dust of kisses.
Suddenly, the music is back.
Listen forwards, now the answer.
The high drums again, proportions.
Evening.
The idea of a place
beyond where the Western Ocean
is not far. The usefulness
of water on the hair, the beauty
glistens,
something interrupted.
The idea, a little worn now.
The divided city,
penance.
As if apart from the idea,
and watching a tango
Berlin.
Einer Berliner, remembered.
I am a half
dollar.
Dallas, Argentina. Fear with
bravery mixed nostalgia.
The biggest building in the world pays me $5 a day. Brand new suit, cigarettes. I don't care what you say. Words can never change it. Money talks. Work is here to stay. I say to them, look, 28,278,466. The figure makes it real, all facing the same way, arms raised, allow their image to be snapped. We're supposed to take that idea seriously. You must be kidding.
But they do.
Almost unimaginable. 28,278,466. Calculated simply, all facing the same way, arms raised, allow their image to be snapped, to represent an idea. You can't believe they could hold still.
But they do.
I try to tell them, I hear others try to tell them that it's a big mistake. It's unspeakable, a flash of light. 28,278,466. Because it happened once, could perish in a flash of light. They deny that they admit the possibility.
But they do. What comes next is what was first, or so they say, as far back as we can go. At least on this system. Notice that we speak of it with awe. As if there were perfection once, that's nice. And as if there is renewal, that's nice too.
Some islands. The first among us. Some islands. Safe place for sailors. Some islands. Lost in an instant. Some islands.